Okay. Alright, so here's what you need. You definitely need your graphing calculators, you need your smarter particles, and you need your homework available. I'm definitely going to pick it up because I want to look over it. I want to see how well last night's homework went. For the most part, did it go well?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not
after
definitely.
I got it.
I mean, it should have been plug into your new formula.
Oh, that.
Right.
Yeah. It's also important to read that calculators were allowed because I almost did it all.
Yeah, okay, yeah. All right, today your world changes in a way we're not going to go back after today. So hope you're ready. Up until today, all the calculus we have done has been flat, two-dimensional sorts of things. Lewis the artist is very excited about what's about to happen. Today, my friends, we are going to go into the third dimension.
Yay.
We're going to talk about volume. If there is time later on in the Calculus BC curriculum, we're also going to talk about surface area, which is another three-dimensional thing. But for now, we're just going to ooh and ah appropriately as we go from the flat world to the three-dimensional. I said ooh and ah.
Ooh.
Good. All right. Man, I got to work hard for this stuff. All right, so you know, right now I've just got some graph over here, and you've got this in your notes somewhere. What page are we on?
17.
Okay, so we've got some function f of x, and if I asked you guys to find the area, oh my God, what an easy question. If I asked you to find the area bounded by the curve and the x-axis from 0 to 6, what I would hope is everybody would say, gosh, I know exactly how to do that. I'm going to do an integral from 0 to 6 of f of x dx. Okay? What if I wanted the arc length? I don't want the area. I'm not asking for all of this stuff. I'm going back to that little bug that is confined to walk along the curve. What's the formula? You just need to have this one unlocked. Myra, what's the formula for arc length?
S.
I'm sorry, what was that that just came
arc
out of your mouth?
Arc
S?
Oh,
arc length. Also referred to as S. I was like, no! S?
I was like,
the definite integral.
This is the S I thought you were talking about. I wanted to vomit. Okay.
From 0 to 6.
Square root
1
plus
the dy dx.
1 plus dy dx, or maybe you want to refer to it as f prime that gets squared.
Dx.
Everybody okay? Okay. Area, this f of x represented, what did this represent? Think about area. Think about how we find area. The f of x stood for, think about that little representative slice, yeah. This represented the height, and the dx stood for the width. And that's the way that we go about finding areas of rectangles, right? You say height times width, the integral is an accumulation, the area integral says add them all up, and we're gonna get the area, we're okay? Now, this guy in here, this is a little bit wonkier. Like some textbooks, if you look it up, they're gonna say it's the integral from 0 to 6 of dx, the whole thing squared, plus dy, the whole thing squared. We're going to loop our way back around to this when we talk about parametric curves. Oh my God, I can't wait for that. It's like my favorite thing to teach. You may have heard that already.
I want to just create a video of you saying that.
It's my favorite thing to teach. And it would be like all my different polos and every different lesson. I'm like, I love teaching this. It's the best thing to teach. It's my favorite unit. I think there's a reason, I think there's a good reason why textbooks present it this way. There's something that they're trying to get you to remember. There's a connection that they're wanting you to make here. Who's got it? What's the connection here? One person? Maybe two people? Maybe three? Polymon, what's the connection here?
A squared plus B squared.
A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Yes, but what is this really?
The thing, because when you square root it, it's the...
Begins with a D. Ends in Istin's formula. Yeah, we'll make a video of that as well, right? So I think the reason that they do that, they're like, oh, think about distance formula. But this is the version that we're working with right now. Square root of 1 plus derivative squared with respect to x. Everybody okay? If this makes sense to you, this is going to make sense to you. David, if you want to go on back to the laptop, you're going to drive. Because the key to volume, God, that looks good. The key to, that looks good too, man, I'm just hungry. The key to finding volume is to go back to your representative slice. So here's my representative slice, this little guy over here. What I'm going to have to do with all these volume questions is you are going to identify an axis of rotation. The axis of rotation, also referred to as the axis of revolution in some textbooks, is the line that you're going to spin the region around. So I'm going to take this region over here, and from 0 to 6, and I want to spin it around my axis of rotation, which in this case is the x-axis. So for those of you that are really good with the visuals, we're going to do this a lot. For those of you that aren't really good with the visuals, we're going to do this a lot. Have a conversation with somebody near you. If you were to take this shape and spin it around the x-axis, what does that three-dimensional object look like? There's no wrong answers here. Talk to somebody near you. I got you.
Kind of looks like I'm going to start
with Kirby doing things.
This
will do. Alright. Y'all make me hungry.
Alright, so let's hear. What are some of the visuals here?
Base.
You see a base. Anybody else see a base?
Yeah.
Okay, maybe you don't see a base anymore because I've had attendance up here. What else? What else? If you see a base, you see a base. What else might we see? There's no bad answers here.
A wine cup.
Like a wine goblet, maybe? Right? Like this is the handle down here. This is like
the spout.
The spout. Anything else? I've heard some people say they see a whale.
What?
Oh.
Did you see the whale?
What?
I kind of think it's a whale that had its head chopped off. But whale? I asked Caroline a couple of years ago, the first time we were doing this, I was like, what do you see? Because I was like really testing her to see if she's actually smart. And what she said was, I see Cinderella's dress.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
And at first I was like, what? That makes no sense. Does anybody else see Cinderella's dress?
Yeah.
Imagine Cinderella kind of like laying down, right? She's got like that big poofy ball gown thing that kind of like goes out over here. Now, gentlemen, we're not going to talk about what's happening up here. Okay, like this is her waist, this is the big dress. Up here, we don't know. We don't speak of this. Everybody okay? All right, oh, David!
I am going.
I know, but you're going slowly. What I want to do is I want to take this representative slice, the rectangle, and spin that. So, David, I want you to click revolve one rectangle. Watch it. Ooing and aahing is coming. That one rectangle gets spun. And what happens? What do you form with that one rectangle?
A circular.
There's a fancy word for this.
A disc.
You could call it a disc. You could call it a plate. No, like fancy mathematical word.
Oh, a cylinder.
You could call it a cylinder. You could call it a disc. Now, is everybody okay? That is giving you a three-dimensional representation of what happens with the representative slice. What I want is the whole thing. I think you guys know exactly what we're going to do. More rectangles. Spin them all. David, spin those beautiful rectangles. See all discs. And what you're going to get is a whole bunch of discs. And the plan, I'm sure you guys know exactly what we're going to do. We're going to figure out the way to find the volume of one, and then what? You add them all up, and that's going to give you the exact volume?
And then approximation.
It's going to give you an approximation. And how are we going to move from approximation to the final answer?
Base. the limit.
You take the limit as?
N
approaches
infinity. N approaches infinity, where N is the number of slices. And we're going to get some integration formula. Everybody good? Uh-huh. We got this under control? Good. All right. Now, David, you might want to come on back. And Lewis, if you can turn the lights on. Because what we need to do is have a geometry conversation here. We need to talk about the geometry. Whoa, on. I was getting scared. Eileen was getting the shiv. She was going to like stab me. Giselle was right there with her because it's a quiet one. You gotta worry about in prison.
She still wasn't saying anything.
Oh yeah,
she's like,
yes,
no.
And
it's always the biggest people you should be scared of.
No, it's the biggest people you go after first. It's the quiet ones.
Oh.
I watch my Orange Is the New Black. I know what's going on. Alright. Here comes. Alright, so what I want to do is I want to focus on this one little rectangle over here. But really, we know there's a whole bunch, right? If I'm going over here from, let's call this x equals a, all the way over to x equals b, I'm going to do something, fancy word first.
Partition.
I'm going to partition. I'm going to chop up my interval. I'm going to make some rectangles. And I'm going to use, maybe it's the right endpoint method, maybe it's the left. I'm not even too terribly worried about that. Right, we've been here before. Okay. Yeah. Moving on. All right. Well, what I know is that for any of these rectangles, let's say the first one, the second one, the third one, all the way out to the last one, well, when I spin them, they each have a volume. The true volume is going to be approximately what I get by taking the volume of the first, and the volume of the second, and the volume of the third, all the way out to the volume of the nth one, and I add them all together. What I want to do is I want to zoom in on just the first one, just so we can figure out how would you find the volume. What you guys told me is when I take this little rectangle and I spin it around my axis of rotation, we get a cylinder. Volume of a cylinder. Who's got it for me?
V-R squared times this.
I mean, volume of a cylinder has nothing to do with one-third.
Pi r squared times
pi.
Right?
Pi r squared times
pi.
Oh, pi r
squared times
pi.
Right, cylinder we're thinking can. Here we go. I heard some folks say, oh, it's like big B times H, the significance of big B, that's the area of the base. The base is a circle. So the volume of the cylinder here is pi times the radius squared times the height. And here's where you need to be careful. For the representative rectangle, when I spin it, the radius is actually the distance from the axis of rotation up to the curve. That's your radius. The height of the cylinder is actually this guy over here. Right, and it's a little counterintuitive for height, I think, go up. For the cylinder, the height is the distance between the bases. So if I wanted to find the volume here, well, what I would do is I'd say it's pi times my radius. How do I determine the radius? It's the value of the function at this particular point. So I'll call it f of x sub 1 squared times I need to multiply this by the height, which is the thickness, right, which is your delta x, which I'm going to call delta x sub 1, because it's possible that this is a non-uniform partition. I've kind of chopped it up. This is the volume for one cylinder. I go to the next one. Plus pi f of x sub 2 squared times whatever the width there is. And I go 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 all the way up to pi times f of x sub n squared times delta x sub n squared. I bet you guys know what the next move is. There's something really clever that you want to do because they all have the same form.
Oh, factor out?
Not even factoring out, but there's a better way to write this.
Sigma.
With sigma notation, we're going to say that this guy here is the sum. I goes from 1 to n. But there's a whole unit that we're going to do that involves these infinite sums. Going to be mind-blowing. I love that unit. It's my favorite to teach. Okay. Pi f of x sub I, the whole thing squared, times delta x sub I. This is an approximation to your actual volume. So now what? Right. Your volume is actually going to be equal to, because this guy here right now is simply an estimate. Your volume is the limit as n approaches infinity of the sum from 1 to n, pi f of x sub I squared times delta x sub I. And oh my gosh, we've seen this move before. It's a little bit of a hand-wavy thing, but this infinite sum, the limit as n approaches infinity of this guy here of this form, this is where the definite integral comes into play. Where do I start integrating? At x equals whatever my starting point is, 0, 6, 2, whatever. Where do I stop integrating? At x equals b. My integrand, right, the thing that I'm actually going to integrate, it's all over here. It's going to be pi times f of x squared times dx. Hopefully the setup and kind of like how we get there makes sense on some level. If it doesn't, I hope at least this part makes sense. You're like, this is the new formula that I just need to memorize and make flashcard. Now, some textbooks are going to write it this way, and I'm curious how we feel about this. Is it different? Is it the same? If it's the same, somebody tell me why. Why are these the same? I see David, I see Celeste, I see Carmen. Ila, why are they the same?
Because pi is a constant.
Right, pi is a constant. Because pi is a constant, I can just factor the pi out in front. This is generally the way I deal with my volume expression. I'm going to say it's pi, integral from a to b, the function gets squared, dx. This is your newfound volume formula that just needs to get memorized, and the best way to memorize it is use it again and again and again. Big picture, everybody okay? What questions are out there before we actually like start playing around with this? Everybody's good? All right, cool. All right, let's do this first one. I'll give you a minute to play around with this, see what you can do, and we'll talk. Okay, I'm at the top of page 20. Let R represent the region bounded by the upper half of the circle defined by x squared plus y squared equals 9 and the x-axis. Find the volume of the solid formed when region R is revolved around the x-axis. I'm just going to move this over to the other side of the board as like our new friend. Represent the region bounded by the upper half of the circle defined by x squared plus y squared equals 9, the x-axis. What do we know about this circle? Do we know anything about this circle? keep in mind, your pre-calculus teacher is sitting there right now.
Not listening.
Not listening. Now he's listening. We've got a circle. The equation for all circles in the coordinate plane looks like x minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared. If x squared plus y squared equals 9, what I should know for sure, radius is 3. Other thing we know for sure? The center, where is it? Is at the origin. So let's just get a quick sketch here. Here's my sketch. My center is at the origin. I'm going to go 3 up, 3 to the right, 3 to the left. There is something that's supposed to represent a circle. Okay. Center at 0, 0. I need to know where do I start my integration, where do I end my integrating. I start at negative 3. I end at positive 3. Is everybody okay? Think about your representative slice. Your representative slice is going to go like something like that. For my volume expression, it's going to be pi and integral from negative 3 to 3. What I need to know, though, is what is your function that's going to get squared with respect to x? And you're going to have to come back to this guy over here and do a little bit of work. You can't work with x squared plus y squared equals 9. You need to get this into, like, y equals form. So what is that? Y squared equals 9 minus x squared, so y is square root of 9 minus x squared, technically, plus or minus? It's the upper half, so I'm only going to look at that guy over there. Okay, great. So I only go with that. So my volume expression is going to be pi, an integral from negative 3 to 3, square root of 9 minus x squared, squared, dx. And before anybody has a total panic attack, I want to tell you how I'm going to score this. If you get the constant and the limits of integration correct, probably 1 point earned. If your integrand is correct, another point earned. That's just for like plugging in. And now you're going to have to do some work. We have to integrate. Square root 9 minus x squared, the whole thing squared? Those guys are going to cancel each other out, right? So I've got pi, I've got an integral from negative 3 to 3 of 9 minus x squared. Dx, and I would hope it's pretty easy for everybody to integrate this one. Integral of 9, what do we got? Should be 9x, mine, not 0, integral, right? Powers go up. Integral of x squared is 1 third x cubed. Show me that evaluate bar from negative 3 to 3. Plug in the top limit. 9 times 3 is 27. Minus 3 cubed. 3 times 3 times 3, 27. Take a third of it, 9, minus pi. Plug in the negative 3, 9 times negative 3, negative 27, minus, plug in the negative 3 here, negative 3 cubed, negative 27. Take a third of that, was that negative 9? Simplify. I think we get 18 pi, minus, that's really plus negative 18 pi, which is 36 pi. Did anybody else get 36 pi? Okay. Now, here's the thing. I'll give you guys a second to get caught up. We took the top half of a circle and we spun it around the axis of rotation, which is the x-axis. What are we going to get?
A sphere.
You're going to get a sphere. Right? There's an H in there, not a sphere. A sphere. Right? You take this, more moving an iron, here it comes.
Ooh.
That, no, no! More ooing and aahing, here it comes. We took the upper half of a circle. I went to Party City like 8 years ago and bought these. Okay, you take the upper half of a circle and you're gonna spin it around the x-axis and you're gonna get a
sphere.
Here we go, here we go.
Ooh.
Thank you. Man, I work hard around here. Now, so your three-dimensional object that you're gonna get is actually a sphere. You know how to find the volume of a sphere. Right? What you're going to get is a sphere, and the volume of a sphere is 4/3 pi r cubed. This is the calculus way of finding that volume. The geometry way says, okay, plug it in. So 4/3 pi times 3 cubed. 3 cubed, 27. 4/3 of 27. Find 1/3 of 27, which is 9.
36 pi.
36 pi. Same thing. Mind blown. At least mine is.
Wow.
So, Lewis, what's your question?
Can we use that instead of the other one?
Yes, indeed. The next time I ask you to take the upper half of a semicircle and spin it around the x-axis, you can go, we're past that time. The next time I ask you to do that, you are more than welcome to use the volume formulas for a sphere. The problem, though, is there's maybe 5 or 6 things in the world that the 10 of you can find the volume of. You know formulas for volume of a sphere. What else? Cylinder.
Rectangular prism.
Rectangular prism.
Triangular prism.
You know cones. There are formulas for cones. Cubes. We're up to like 4 now.
Pyramids.
Five. Rectangular pyramids. All these things are very boring. They're not sexy like Cinderella's dress or the whale with no head. Those are boring. I could have done better. So the rest of today, we're going to look at non-boring shapes. So model problem number 2, take a minute, work with somebody near you, see what you can do. We'll talk in a bit. If you've got the big idea, you're going to be just fine. Boring. Now an apocalypse pops out of it. That's not boring. That was scary. My recommendation for you guys with all of these things, start with a sketch. Give yourself a little sketch. Don't go all OCD on this. Is going to represent the region bounded by f of x equals x squared, the x-axis, and the vertical lines x equals 0 and x equals 3. Find the volume of the solid formed when the region is revolved around the x-axis. Yeah, take a little bit of time. Find that region. Mark it up. Why, hello, Mr. Newcomer. And hello, Ms. Feinberg. And hello, all the other friends.
Hi, Keith DeRozier.
Paula.
Hi, Keith, I'm sick. Nice to meet you, sick before. Hey, nice to see you. Feel free to walk around. We're doing volume of revolution. My calculus PC class. These are 10 wicked, smart individuals. And there's the camera, because the class also goes shared with the kids at our East End, North Central.
So they're taking this class right now.
So yeah, it's not, they're not getting it live. They're getting, I'll like post the video once class is over, and then they'll be able to watch it
and
study it's really hard to like do calculus BC in addition to each of the courses, so this is a way that we've found to kind of like close that. This one was an opportunity.
It looked like a cube.
No, yeah, we'll be
Alright. So if you guys notice, I'm being kind with the shapes. And I've got just about everybody's paper. We've got y equals x squared. You've got the x-axis. Here's x equals 0. Here's x equals 3. And we've got that little region that we're spinning. Everybody's okay? Okay, if you spin that region around the x-axis, I'd love to hear from you guys. What do you see? What's the visual? I'm not interested in the math right now. What's the visual that comes to mind? Just Celeste? Myra, what do you got? It looks like a volcano, right? We're taking this and we're spinning around the x-axis, just like a little bit ago when we were taking the upper half of the semicircle and spinning it around the x-axis to get the
sphere.
Ready?
Ooh!
Ah. We didn't practice that at all. Totally legit. All right, so Myra sees a volcano. What else are we seeing?
A hut.
A cone, a hut. Nobody else is hungry.
What?
Take that little thing, spin it around the x-axis.
Oh, Hershey's Kiss.
A Hershey's Kiss. Right? Like, David's like, yeah, the Hershey's Kiss. All right, so now let's go to the volume formula. Volume equals pi. We're doing an integral from where to where?
0 to 3.
Your function is x squared. That guy gets squared dx. Pretty good. So once you're here, you've got your first point locked in. You've got your constant and your limits of integration. You've got your integrand. Life is good. All we need to do, finish it off. Palamon, what are we going to do next?
So it's going to be 1/3 to the x cubed.
1/3 x cubed? I don't know that I'm in love with 1/3 x cubed. There's something really important that you're missing, Palamon. Right, we've got to figure out what's x squared squared. Which is
x
to the power, x to the fourth power. Now everybody can tell me if I integrate x to the fourth, what are we going to get?
x to the fifth over five.
X to the fifth over five. Maybe you see this as 1/5 x to the fifth. So pi times 1/5 x to the fifth. Evaluate from 0 to 3. Pi times 1/5 3 to the fifth. Pi times 1/5 0 to the fifth. If this is the free response part of the exam, please don't simplify this at all. If it's multiple choice, I do need you to know what 3 to the 5th is.
2,
1.
160.
I love it when the auction starts.
273.
No, too high.
162.
162, not even the bummer. Say it with me, 3 times 3.
9.
Times 3.
27.
Times 3 again.
50.
81. Oh, one more time.
243.
Okay. So 243 pi over 5 minus good news. 0. Everybody good? Alright, you guys are clearly ready for a challenge. So with your partner, see what you can do with model problem number 3. Take the time, get the setup, get the region. These are kind curves. And we'll talk in a little bit.
Can I stay for the rest of the class?
You can stay forever. I would love somebody to like grade my stuff. These guys are 8th grade?
7th grade.
These are 6th grade. And we've got 91 days until the AP exam starts or until the AP exam arrives. So I teach Calc BC, and I teach you Calc AB, which are our new calculus teachers, one here and one for tonight. And I get to teach our advanced quantitative reasoning course, which is a course designed for KBC. But that not necessarily has anything to do with my theory or human. So there are statistics, a lot of experimental design, option study. Today we're going to look at really, like, these are going to be like pleasure to have you guys here.
Okay. Good luck on the AP test, you guys.
No, they don't need luck. They're prepared.
Oh. Sorry.
That's all right. It's all right. I'll forgive you. He's sick and delirious, so it's okay. Alright, seeing some good sketches.
Thank you.
Sketches.
Oh, these sketches.
These are sketches. I don't need them to be perfect. I'm also not gonna go crazy here. These are all kind curves. So we get square root of x. Here we go. F of x equals the square root of x. We've got g of x is negative x plus 6. Negative x plus 6. We've got the x-axis. And we're revolving around the x-axis. This is the region that we're spinning. Ready, okay? Spin this in your head. What does it look like? What do you see? They're never going to ask you that question in the college board exam. What do you see? Nobody cares what you see. I care what you see.
A pizza cone.
A pizza cone?
Yes.
Making stuff up.
No, it's
Thank
real.
You for letting the board members out of the room before you said that. A pizza cone is a real thing?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, pizza cone's a real thing. Apparently I need to get out more. I was thinking...
Snow cone.
Snow cone? Ice cream cone? What you got? A jewel of some sort.
Ooh.
Ah, there. Now here's the... Okay. So no matter how you see it, now we have to have a conversation. You want to find the volume. There is a new challenge here. Does anybody see the challenge that we're going to run into here? Lewis sees it. David sees it. Carmen, you see it. What's the challenge here? Look at that region. Lewis, what do you see that's going to be a challenge here?
We have two graphs.
You have two graphs. Tell me more. Build off that idea. What's going to be the problem here?
Oh.
David, what's going to be the problem?
You can't just write it in one.
You can't do this in one integral. Because, go back to your representative slice. It all goes back to the slice. Think about the things that you're revolving. Here's my little slice. Well, guess what happens? What's the height here? F of x. What's the height over here? G of x. There's a change. Where does that change happen? You guys know where that change happens. It changes at the intersection point. That's the key. That's where life changes for you. So what you need is you need to figure out the intersection point. So go find the intersection point. To find the intersection point, square root of x equals negative x plus 6. You either are able to just look at this and know what the intersection point is, or you do some algebra. The algebra that I'm thinking about here is like I can square both sides. Square root of x, the whole thing squared is x. Square this over here, but don't tell me x squared plus 36. Everyone's gonna get quiet now.
X squared minus 12x plus 36.
Yeah, this is x squared minus 12x plus 36. You need to think of this as negative x plus 6 times negative x plus 6 and distribute and combine like terms. I need to solve this, it's quadratic. So I'm gonna say 0 equals x squared minus 13x plus 36. I can factor, I'm going fast with this part because this is just algebra 1, algebra 2 stuff. And we get x equals 4 or x equals 9. Love watching the faces. Some of you are realizing that there's something wrong here. Something has just happened that shouldn't happen. Polyman, what's the problem?
They don't intersect twice.
They don't intersect twice. They intersect one time. There's one of these that actually isn't a solution. And the way that you decide, you have to go back to the originals. Before there was squaring, there was this equation. One of these solutions will work, the other one doesn't work. Which one doesn't work?
4.
If you plug in 4, you get square root of 4, which is 2. Over here?
Oh,
you get 2.
9.
That works. 9 doesn't work. The square root of 9 is 3, but on the right-hand side of the equation, you get negative 3. This guy over here, the fancy word, is an extraneous solution. It's extraneous. So if the intersection point is at x equals 4, everybody okay that we're going to start integrating at x equals 0?
Yes.
And we're going to integrate from 0 to 4, and that's going to give me one integral. And then the next one starts over here at x equals 4, and where does that one end?
6.
At x equals 6. Hopefully that's one you guys can like pick up right away. Here's what I want. I just want you to set up the integrals. Don't worry about evaluating them. I just want to make sure that we're having some good conversations. Everybody okay with the setup?
Mm-hmm.
How many of you guys have that exactly? Nice. Trust your instincts. Now here's the thing. I am confident that you all can do square root of x squared to get x and find the antiderivative and plug in. Those are not the skills I'm worried about right now. If this was an AB class, I'd go a little bit slower. I'd say, hey, finish it off, blah, blah, blah. Over here, we can square it, we can integrate. Right now, I'm just interested in you guys like seeing the setups and going from there.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody good?
Mm-hmm.
Pacing's all right?
Mm-hmm.
Good. All right. When you run into the board members later, just tell them I did an excellent job. All right, time for a new push. Problem number 4. What was that, Celeste?
Why does David have box water?
I don't know. There's only so many things I can worry about. I'm trying to get him to do his homework, okay? All right, number 4. See what you can do. And thank you for oohing and aahing at all the right times. It was so authentic.
It's like you never practice.
Ooh and ah, damn it.
Homer Kyle.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh,
this is the wrong one.
Get those regions, we need to talk about them. Sir, beautiful. No crinkly edges. Just the way God intended. Okay, that it's like this part here, like this little, like maybe it looks like a leaf to you or something, and we're spinning around x-axis. What does this look like?
A flower petal.
Okay, it looks like a flower petal, but spin
a leaf.
Gonna go
that
3-dimensional.
That like is folded
like a plate.
I don't know.
So you're seeing a plate?
Oh,
maybe like a bowl.
That's
weird.
Yeah.
I don't know that I've actually seen this 3-dimensional version a lot. I also don't have a thing to like ooh and ah over. Sorry. But okay, like the leaf is kind of like coming out of the board. You're revolving. Something's different with this one. What's the word? There's a hollow center. Lewis, what was it that you said? Okay. Basically, like you're missing a piece. I need you to have a strategy conversation. What would you do? How would you find the volume if there's a piece missing? Trust your instincts here.
from like zero to wherever that is.
Hey there.
Of the.
Trust your instincts. I can think of at least two different ways you could approach this. You're okay with the fact that it's hollow?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So, one approach that some folks like to use is they say, what if it was solid? Envision this thing solid first, meaning they say, let me find the volume if the top piece in its entirety was revolved around the x-axis. Everybody okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully, like, nice and easy. You're like, oh, then it's going to be volume pi. What's the top one?
Y.
Is that square root of x?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Squared dx. I'm going to start at x equals 0, and for the sake of time, I'll tell you that this intersection point is at x equals 1.
Yeah.
Okay. This would be the volume if the whole thing was solid. But it's not solid. It's hollow. There's a piece missing.
Minus Q of X.
So all you have to do, subtract out the part that you don't want. Right, this is the piece that I don't want, so knock it out. So you say minus pi integral, still from 0 to 1. Now you need to tell me what the function is that's getting squared here. Right? It's going to be this inside piece, it's going to be x squared that gets squared and we integrate with respect to x. All the friends okay? Okay. Another approach looks like this. Have a conversation with somebody near you. Is that even legal?
Yeah.
Right. And if it's legal, what are they doing? I need to be convinced that it's legal.
Yeah. That's the way I was thinking about it.
That's why you're going. Does that work? Alright, this is the like solid minus the part that I don't want. This guy over here, these are algebraic equal to each other. What's happening? What's happening going from here down to this guy here? Stephen, what do you see that's happening?
What? Wait.
Going from these two integrals down to this one integral.
Well, since they have the same starting and ending point.
The same starting and ending points, the same limits of integration.
Yeah. You can actually combine them. And
right, it's that property of integrals that says, like, same limits of integration here and here. If it's addition or subtraction, I can combine them in a one integral. What about the pi?
It's the same.
The pi is a constant, so you're like kind of like factoring out in front of the whole thing. And so it's like pi integral from 0 to 1. First guy squared minus the second guy squared dx. Okay? All right, one last push. Model problem number 5. We'll talk in a little bit. I know we're going way fast, and you guys are doing a great job. Somebody that's like, but wait, sir, you actually are doing the same region again. It's the same problem. And I say, no, it's not the same problem. I like, why is it not the same problem? What's different? You're going to revolve around the y-axis. You're spinning this way. You want to take this region here and spin it around the y-axis. Trust your instincts. What has to happen? What has to happen? Palamon, what has to happen there? You want to think about your representative slices. I know you didn't say it that way exactly. You want to think about integrating not with respect to x, with vertical slices. We need to have horizontal slices. Everybody okay with that? So this is a, hello, Mr. Tran.
Hello.
What kind? We're doing slices this way, right? So this way is what?
dy.
This is a dy kind of integral. Everything is going to be in terms of y. Oh, and guess what? Hollow, just like this little like space where some people like store a heart, for me it's hollow. So my volume is going to be pi. I need to do an integral from y equals something to y equals something.
0 to 1.
But because what I'm looking at now are the y values, not the x values, you need to take this big guy here, which goes from the y-axis to y equals x squared, and this is going to be, you have to be careful. If y equals x squared, that means that x is the square root of y. So it's going to be square root of y squared dy.
Minus,
because we're hollow, y equals 0 to y equals 1, and this guy here is going to be y squared dy. Because of the hollow piece. Okay, so I just want to make sure we're clear on tonight's homework. Tonight's homework is assignment 121. Problems 1 and 2, I want you to do 1 and 2 tonight. Be ready to talk about them tomorrow when you walk into class. I'm not going to pick them up tomorrow because I want you to have another day of practice in class. So you're going to do 1 and 2 tonight. 3 and 4 is tomorrow night's homework. Everything's due to me on Thursday. Thursday, there's going to be a take-home quiz that's going to be due Friday. See you later. Yep.